So for the last few days, we were talking about the differential amplifier, and we have already identified the different important advantages associated with the differential amplifier. And in the very last class, we have calculated one important parameter pertaining to the characteristics of any differential amplifier, which is known as CMRR or a common mode rejection ratio. So in fact, our objective is always to improve the value of CMRR, which is nothing but the ratio of two different gains, that is ADM upon ADM slash GM. So here today, let me start with the basic differential pair. Involving the resistances, MOS devices, and obviously the current source. And you understand what is the implication of having the current source, the tail current source, which is connected at the source, between the source and the ground. So as to ensure that this VNCM, the input common mode voltage that you're applying, does not have much say about the corresponding VOUTCM. I mean, the corresponding change will not take place over there. So let me just draw the basic differential pair. Now, last day we have also identified the different non-ideal conditions, you know, which can take place over there. So one a non-ideal condition might be in the form of having this current source not as an ideal one. So in which case we have seen that instead of having an infinite resistance for this current source, we can have a finite value for the current source. I mean, the finite value of the output impedance for the current source. So if the current source is being represented by ISS, and if I consider that this current source is an ideal one, so in that case, the corresponding output impedance provided by the current source is infinite. So while drawing the small signal equivalent circuit, you can just simply ignore that part, this infinite resistance, which is connected between the source and the ground. But one of the non-ideal condition is that this ISS, this current source, might not be ideal one. It can be a practical current source. And accordingly, the output resistance, you cannot just neglect. The value is very large, but you cannot just neglect. So accordingly, last day we have put on resistance, a very high value resistance, RSS, between the source and the ground. Then coming back to the original diagram, so we do have these two resistances, RD1 and RD2. And you have a supply from this point, that is VDD. And two MOS devices are there, that is M1 and M2. And you are applying the input signal, VIN1, at the gate of the first MOS, and VIN2 at the gate of the second MOS. And the corresponding outputs are obtained from these two terminals. If I call this point as X and this point as Y, then ultimately the final output is nothing but Vx minus Vy. The objective of this differential amplifier is to reduce the common mode fluctuation. So in fact, last year we have made three different changes in this particular differential circuit. First of all, we have used a resistance RSS connected between this point, this source terminal, and ground. In which case, we are assuming that this current source is not ideal. So we are considering a practical current source, and the value of the current, I mean, value of the resistance or output resistance is not infinite, finitely large. That was the first modification which we have done. Then the second modification in the form of unequal resistances, RD1 and RD2. So far in our analysis, we have assumed that this RD1, the drain resistance, which is connected between the drain of this MOS and the VDD supply, and this resistance, which is connected between the drain of the second MOS and the supply, being the same. But sometimes the situation might be like this RD1 may not be equal to RD2. Because you have to remember that whenever we are talking about an integrated circuit, then obviously this RD1 and RD2, they are being represented by some MOS devices. And in fact, this is our discussion, I mean the topic of discussion today. These load resistances, RD1 and RD2. So far, we have just shown those resistances by means of simple resistance, with which we are very much familiar, which we have studied in our electronic circuits course as well. But you have to understand that whenever we are talking about the MOS devices or the circuits associated with the MOS devices, then all the, apart from the amplifier itself, all the passive elements like this resistance and this current source, so everything will be realized with the help of MOS device. So you understand how can you represent this current source by means of MOS device. Similarly, these resistance values can also, I mean the resistance RD1 and RD2 can also be implemented by means of MOS devices. And accordingly, there could have been some mismatch during the manufacturing process, and you cannot ensure that RD1 is equal to RD2 always. So therefore, last day we have made the first assumption that the current source is not ideal, so RSS is not infinite. The second assumption or the second modification which we have considered last day was this RD1 was not equal to RD2, and which makes these two part of the circuit not same. I mean, these two part of the circuit, they are not symmetric. And the third one, the third assumption which we have made last day was this MOS M1 and this MOS M2, these two MOS devices, they are not identical in nature. So that means if I consider the threshold voltage VTH1 of this MOS and the threshold voltage VTH2 of this MOS, they are not the same. And the corresponding transconductance, mutual conductance, GM1 and GM2, they are not the same. And accordingly, whenever we assume this asymmetricity between these two parts of the circuit, if I consider this part as the left part and this one is the right part, or left half and right half, then we have seen that if I consider some asymmetricity in our design, then even if you apply some common mode input, so what do you mean by common mode input? That means when the gates of these two, I mean, gate of the MOS1 and gate of MOS2, they are connected together and you are applying same voltage, which is known as the common mode voltage, VNCM. So when you apply the same voltage, VNCM over here, and if the circuit is symmetric in true sense of the term, then you expect that this VX and VY must be same. But even under this common mode condition, whenever both of these two gates, gate 1 and gate 2, they are supplied with the common signal, same signal, that is VNCM. Now, if the two halves of the circuit, they are not identical, if they are not symmetric, then you see that. So last day, we have already proved that that particular thing, that even if you apply VNC over there, but there is a corresponding differential component being generated at the output, and which you call like a common mode to differential mode gain. And our objective is to minimize this common mode to differential mode gain. And accordingly, we have calculated the CMRR, that is a common mode rejection ratio, which is nothing but the ratio of this ADM and ACM/DM. Now today, our objective is to visualize these resistances, these drain resistances RD1 and RD2 with the aid of MOS devices. Now to do that, we will be using one concept, which is known as half circuit concept. Now let us first try to understand what is meant by this half circuit concept. Now for this, let me just go to the next slide. Now let's say that we do have, let us just divide the circuit in this way. Let us consider we do have a this MOS, left MOS M1. Okay, I think we can do it in that particular thing. I mean, it's not needed to write it once again. Okay, so let me go to this slide only. So we are applying two signals over here. One is VIN1. So we are applying VIN1 over here, which is connected between the gate and the ground terminal, and the second signal, the second input signal was connected between these two, V2, between the second gate and the ground. And let us assume that the current that is being flown is being represented by, say, the current through this path is I1 and current through this path let it be I2. And for the timing, you may assume that RD1 is equal to RD2. Now, if this voltage, this gate to source voltage for MOS1, let this be represented by V1, and this voltage be represented by V2. So this is V1, which is connected between the gate and the ground. Input for the first MOS, V2, input for the second MOS, and V1 is nothing but the gate to source voltage for the first MOS, and V2 is nothing but the gate to source voltage for the second MOS. And let us call this point as, say, point S, the source terminal. Now, the total current I1 plus I2 must be equal to ISS. Total current that is being flown, that must be equal to ISS. Now, let us assume that this V1 and V2, they are having a common mode level of, say, V dashed, and the corresponding differential fluctuation is being represented by, say, delta V in. But this fluctuation is equal and opposite. So let me just wait over here. Suppose this is the common mode level. Let this common mode level is being represented by V dashed, and over and above this common mode level, you have the corresponding fluctuation. So let me assume a sinusoidal variation. This is for, I'm just showing the only the one cycle, I mean one half cycle only. So this is for V1, and suppose this one is for V2. Or you can also show for the full cycle, no problem. Doesn't matter. So both of them are riding on a common mode level, that is V in CM. And the corresponding fluctuation, if I consider, so this blue signifies for V in 1. So suppose this fluctuation is delta V in. If I call this fluctuation as delta V in, and then this fluctuation is also delta V in, but the polarity is just the opposite. So that is the implication of these two different input, V1 and V2. They are riding on a single common mode level, V in CM. The corresponding fluctuations are equal but opposite. Now, under this condition, whenever we apply V1 and V2 accordingly, so let me just mark this one is for V1. This blue one and this green one is for V2. So when the small signal variation takes place over here, so accordingly this I1 and I2 will also be varied, and the corresponding fluctuation of I1 and I2 can be directly obtained from the mutual conductance. Now, if I assume that these two MOS devices, they are having they are sharing same transconductance, that is GM, then this I1 can be represented like GM times delta V1. So delta V1 is the corresponding fluctuation over here. Because you understand V1 is nothing but the gate to source voltage. So GM times this delta V1 will give you the corresponding fluctuation of I1. And for I2, we can write GM times delta V2. Then what about the fluctuation of the total current? So that should be equal to zero because we have a constant current source over here. So that is zero. So from that, we can deduce delta V1 is equal to minus delta V2. So what do you mean by delta V1? So delta V1, if I once again show you a different, let me just show over there. Let me just consider a different common mode level for V1 and V2. Let this be represented by V double dashed. And we see that delta V1 is equal to minus delta V2. So delta V1 is nothing but the corresponding fluctuation in V1 because of the application of V in 1. And delta V2 is the corresponding fluctuation of V2 because of the application of V in 2. So let me just show you the corresponding fluctuation. Suppose I'm assuming once again the sinusoidal variation. So I think it looks okay. So this one is delta V2. And this one is delta V1. And it has been already established that this delta V1 and delta V2, they are equal and opposite by virtue of this one. Now coming back to the potential at this particular point, that is Vs, if I consider, then we can equate Vs from two different aspects. One is V in 1 minus V1, that is equal to Vs. And the second one is V in 2 minus Vs. So what we can write is V in 1 minus V1 is equal to V in 2 minus V2. Because V in 1 minus V1 will give you the potential over here, source potential, and that is equal to V into minus V2. Now, if I allow the corresponding small signal variation to take place over there, so instead of V in 1, what I can write is, so V in 1 is nothing but you have V dashed as the common mode level, and plus you have delta V in. So I can write V dashed plus delta V in. And in place of V1, we can write V double dashed plus delta V1. Now that is also equated to V in 2. So we can write V dashed minus delta V in. Because when delta V in is positive over there for V in 1, then it should be negative for V in 2. So minus you have V double dashed minus delta V2. So from that, this V dashed and V double dashed will get cancelled. And ultimately you have 2 delta V in is equal to delta V1 minus here I have considered this delta V1 delta V2 separately, so let me just consider that I'm not just considering the polarity. So I'm assuming that this V1 can be represented like V double dashed plus delta V1. I'm not bothered about the sign. And V2 can be like V double dashed plus delta V2. In fact, this delta V1 and delta V2, they are related by means of this equation. Delta V1 is equal to minus delta V2. So it should be plus. Because when delta V1 goes positive, then delta V2 is negative and vice versa. So then ultimately you have 2 delta V is equal to delta V1 minus delta V2. And already you have seen that delta V1 is equal to minus delta V2. So that is equal to 2 delta V1. And from that, we can write delta V is equal to delta V1. So it is integration. So delta V in, already we have proved that the fluctuation of V1 and the fluctuation of V2 is equal and opposite. But we do not know the corresponding magnitude. We know that the fluctuation of V1 and the fluctuation of V2 is equal and opposite. So that's why we have got like delta V1 is equal to minus delta V2. But what about the magnitude in relation to the value of delta V? We don't have any idea regarding that. Now we have from this particular expression, we have seen that this delta V is equal to delta V1. That means whatever be the fluctuation that is taking place over here for this input voltage, the same fluctuation will be there for the gate to source voltage. So therefore, the corresponding fluctuation in the input signal gets absorbed by V1, leaving this particular terminal, the source terminal, to have a constant potential. Because what about the source potential? We know the source potential is nothing but V in 1 minus V1. Now V in 1 is having some common mode level, that is V dashed. And over and above this V dashed, you have some fluctuation, this plus delta V in. And what about V1? V1 is also having some different common mode level, that is V double dashed. And over and above this V double dashed, you do have the corresponding fluctuation, that is delta V1. Now, if this delta V in and delta V1, they are the same, then obviously, whenever we compute V in 1 minus V1, so it is having a fixed potential. That means Vs is having fixed potential irrespective of the fluctuation over there. The potential at this particular node is becoming constant. So although the small signal is varied like this, but this potential is always kept constant. Whether we apply only DC, whether we apply only VNCM, or we apply VNCM plus delta V, this potential is also always constant. So therefore, since this potential is always constant, so I can regard this particular potential as AC ground, because it is having a constant potential, even under small signal application. So I can regard this potential at this point as AC ground. So now you can modify the circuit. You have the differential pair. So now you can simply modify the circuit like this. This is the supply line. So now, since this potential is at AC ground, so you can make it ground. These are the two MOS devices, M1, M2. If I just simply assume that these two resistances being the same, and you apply V in 1 MOS and minus v in one the uttermost. Under differential mode operation only, you can make this assumption, and you are taking the corresponding output like this. So this is, this point is x, this point is y. Accordingly, you are calculating the corresponding small signal gain. So you can analyze each of these two pairs separately, and this is known as a half circuit concept. You have basically you have divided or you have broken the circuit into two different parts, and this is only possible whenever we will be performing the differential mode operation. So under differential mode operation only, I can apply V in one in one. I mean, V in one to the gate of one MOS and minus V in one to the gate of the other MOS. And accordingly, you can calculate the corresponding gain. The gain for this one is nothing but minus GM times RD, and for this one is also minus GM times RD. And which is the small signal gain for a differential pair? Normally, the input signal which is applied between, I mean, the gates of these two MOS devices. So, if I do not assume anything, the inputs are nothing but V in one and V in two. So, V in one is applied at the gate of MOS one, that is M one, and V in two is applied to the gate of MOS two. Now, we know that for differential mode operation, I mean, for differential amplifier, the variation of V in one and V in two will be something like that. They are riding on a common DC level, and the corresponding fluctuations are equal and opposite. So whenever we think about V in one and V in two, so we can always write this V in one as the input to the first MOS, V in one plus V in two by two plus V in one minus V in two by two. So we are dividing. We don't know what about the input. These two inputs are independent to each other. These V in one and V in two, they're independent to each other. So you can always write these two inputs like this: V in one plus V in two by two, and then you have plus V in two minus V in one by two. So we're dividing this V in one and V in two into these two terms, into these two components. Now the first component is common. This V in one plus V in two by two is common. So I can consider this component as the common mode voltage. That is nothing but V in CM. Common mode voltage. And what about the second component? The second component is V in one minus V in two by two for V in one, and that is equal to V in two minus V in one by two for V in two. That means the second component, if I consider this second component, if I call this as V in DM, then obviously this part is nothing but minus V in DM. So here V in one is nothing but V in CM plus V in DM, and here V in two is nothing but V in CM minus V in DM. Then as far as the circuit operation is linear, then to find out the overall output of the circuit, you have to apply the notion of superposition theorem. So as you know, for superposition theorem, the overall output is nothing but the summation of the outputs resulting from the different inputs. So first you do the common mode operation, or first you calculate the common mode response. So to calculate the common mode response, you have to apply the same input to each of these two MOSes, that is V in one plus V in two by two, which is nothing but the V in CM. And accordingly, you have to find out the corresponding Vx and Vy. And whenever we find out the differential mode response, that is V in DM, whenever you are applying V in DM. Now remember, the input that you are applying for differential mode operation at the gate of the first MOS, if I call this to be V in DM, then the input that you're applying at the gate of the second MOS is nothing but minus VNDM. So if VNDM is applied over here, then minus VNDM is applied over there. And that is only true for differential mode operation. And then the discussion which we have made right now, then this discussion is valid whenever we talk about the differential mode operation. And then only for differential mode operation only, you can consider this potential, I mean, potential at this particular point to be constant, and accordingly, this can be treated as AC ground. And then you can go by this half circuit concept whenever you do differential mode operation. And this half circuit concept to some extent will help you calculating the corresponding gain in a much simpler way. Now today, what we have planned is we have to implement this load resistance, this RD1 and RD2, by means of MOS devices. Now basically, they are common source stage. If I consider these two MOS pairs, this M1 and M2, they're basically common source. The input is applied at the gate, and the output is collected from the drain terminal. So basically, they're common source stage. So let us first consider to replace this RD, this drain resistance, by means of, say, diode connected loop. So already during our discussion in common source stage, common source amplification, we have talked about this diode connected load. So let's now check what will be the corresponding gain resulting from this diode connected load. Now you have the supply line VDD. As you know, for diode connected load, the gate and drain is shorted. So accordingly, we can have this as the load. And we have this input MOS. This one is known as the load, the upper one, and the lower one is known as the input MOS. And for the right hand half, let me just do this. So gate and drain, they are shorted together. So this one is the input MOS. On the right hand half. And this current source can also be implemented by means of MOS devices. And we have already shown that part in some earlier classes. So this is the input signal that you are going to apply. And accordingly, the output is the differential output between these two drain terminals. So let me just name the MOS devices. So let it be M1. This BM2, this BM3, this BM4. So this is the input signal that we're applying. In fact, the gain for this differential mode, a differential amplifier, is given by Vout1 minus Vout2 upon Vin1 minus Vin2. Now, if I call Vin1 minus Vin2 as Vin, so this is Vin, and Vout1 minus Vout2 to be Vout, this one is Vout. So the gain is nothing but the voltage gain is nothing but Vout upon Vin. But remember, this output voltage is measured with respect to two defined nodes, and none of the node is held at a constant potential, unlike a single ended amplifier. Now you have to find out the expression for the gain. Now, once again, we can go by this analysis that we have made right now, this half circuit concept. So if I go by the half circuit concept, then for differential mode operation, what we can do is we can just consider that the connected source terminal is having a constant potential, and therefore we can redraw this part, any of the parts. So let me just redraw the left part only, left half of the circuit. So this is a diode connected load. So this one is VDD, and this serves as the load resistance. And we'll be taking the output from this terminal. So let this be Vout. This one is Vin. It's a simple common source stage, as you understand. And for a simple common source stage, the voltage gain is given by, obviously it will be negative. AV will be negative. And the value is minus GM times M1, this one is M3, minus GM times RT. But the RT will be different over here because we are not using an explicit resistance over here. Rather, we are using one MOS device. And you have to remember what was the output resistance for a diode connected load. So for a diode connected load, if you can remember, the output impedance was given by 1 upon GM in shunt with RO. If I just neglect the body effect, then the output impedance for a diode connected load, if I just visualize a resistance over there connected between this drain and the source, so that value is equal to 1 upon GM in shunt with RO, RO of this MOS, that is MOS 3. Now, since this MOS is a P-type MOS, so what you can write is the overall gain, the voltage gain, there will be minus sign outside, GM times, now this GM is coming from this input MOS, and since the input MOS is of N type, so I can write GMN, GMN, and then multiplied with RD. And what about the RD over here? RD is the resistance, the small signal resistance connected between the drain terminal to AC ground. Now you do have two resistances over there. One resistance is coming from this MOS itself, M3 itself, and that resistance is nothing but the output impedance of the diode connected load, and which was equal to 1 upon GM parallel R0. So we have already calculated that part during our discussion in hopefully in unit 2. So that resistance, that output resistance, is given by 1 upon GM parallel R0. And apart from that, you do have another resistance, and that resistance is coming for this MOS, this input MOS. So if I just consider the channel length modulation, then obviously we do have another RO which is connected between the drain and the ground, drain and the source of this MOS M1. Then ultimately the overall gain, if I just write, it is nothing but, sorry, it will be 1 upon GM, 1 upon GM P parallel ROP parallel RON. So this is the overall gain of this combination. Now since ROP and RON, since they are pretty large with respect to this 1 upon GM, so therefore what we can do, we can just in the shunt combination, parallel combination, we can just neglect this higher value resistance, and we can approximate the voltage gain to be GMN upon GMP. This is nothing but the ratio of two transconductance. Now we know the corresponding relation between the transconductance and the other parameter of the MOS. Already we know that GM, the transconductance of any MOS, can be represented like twice mu Cox W by L into ID. Now under this condition, if I just write down the expression for AV, so then AV can be represented like, if I assume that both of these two MOS devices, since they are fabricated on the same substrate, so obviously the oxide capacitance will be the same. But one MOS is N-type, the other MOS is P-type. So there will be change in terms of mu. And as far as the drain current is concerned, both of them are in series, M1 and M3, they are in series. So the drain current that is flown, that will be constant. I mean, the same drain current will be flowing through M1 and M3. So therefore, once again, ID M3 and ID M1 will be the same. So ultimately, the expression for the voltage gain is given by mu N W by L NMOS upon mu P W by L of the PMOS. Now what happens is, if you consider that W by L of the NMOS and W by L of the PMOS, if I assume that this aspect ratio, this W by L ratio for these two MOS being the same, then the problem is that the voltage gain that you are getting over here is not that large, because it is nothing but square root of mu N upon mu P. And mu N and mu P, these two values are almost fixed, and you can get like square root of, so this mu N is like 10 to 20 times higher as compared to mu P. Then ultimately you have mod AV. If you just compute that mod AV value is close to, say, square root of 10. Now, if you want to increase the value of the voltage gain, so let me just talk about the mod of AV, because we would be interesting in, I think this one is like mu N, it's W by L N upon mu P W by L P. So that is the modulus, I mean the magnitude of the gain, and given by square root of mu N into W by L of the NMOS upon mu P W by L of the PMOS. So we don't have any control over mu N and mu P. So in order to increase AV, or mod AV rather, what we can do is, for a fixed W by L N, we can reduce this W by L P. If I reduce that part, W by L P, then obviously, apparently, it seems that the voltage gain can be increased to some extent. For a fixed drain current, if you just increase the, or if you just reduce the value of W by L P, then the gain can be increased. So mathematically, there is no problem with this particular understanding. But apart from that, you have to follow another important observation. Since both of these two MOS devices, they are in the series path, so therefore, if I just equate the current, then what I'll be getting? If I just equate the current, so since they are operating in the saturation region, so I can write like half mu N Cox W by L of the NMOS into VGS minus VTH of, here it will be M1 square. That is the expression for the drain current. That must be equal to half mu P Cox W by LP VGS minus VTH of M3 whole square. Now you cannot change mu N and mu P. Cox is constant. Now for a fixed gate to source, I mean the overdrive voltage for the MOS 1, if you make any attempt to reduce the value of W by LP, then to make this entire expression valid, this VGS minus VTH for M3 will be higher. So if you make any attempt to make W by L, that ratio, W by L for the PMOS, if you make any attempt to reduce this one so that the gain can be increased, it implies that VGS minus VTH, in fact, that will be negative, so I may consider this modulus of this one for M3 will be enhanced. So any attempt which can reduce W by L of MOS3 less, it will ultimately imply the overdrive voltage for the MOS3 for the PMOS to be large. Then what is the implication? If VGS minus VTH, I mean the overdrive voltage for the PMOS increases, then the corresponding available voltage swing for the output voltage is limited. Because as you know, here our objective is to make each of these two MOS devices in the saturation region. Then the condition is that, you know, to make M3 in the saturation region, the corresponding drain to source voltage should be greater than the gate to source minus the threshold voltage. Now, if the gate to source minus the threshold voltage mod of this, if this value is increased, then automatically the corresponding available voltage for the drain to source voltage, for the drain to source of the PMOS is reduced, the available swing is reduced. So once again, there is a trade-off. There is a trade-off between the voltage gain and the available voltage swing. So if you make any attempt to increase the voltage gain of this particular combination, and that can only be achieved by reducing the value of W by LP, then this can be optimized from the expression of this overdrive voltage of the upper MOS. So if you make any attempt to reduce W by LP, ultimately it will increase the value of VGS minus VTH for the PMOS. Then obviously you have to find out some means so that this problem can be solved. We would be liking to increase the value of the voltage gain, but without compromising the available voltage swing. So that can be done. So once again, if you just look at the expression of this transconductance, mutual conductance, then obviously you cannot have any control over this mu n and COX. Suppose for a particular CMOS technology, COX, I'm just considering COX to be constant and mu n is also fixed. So by some means, if you can reduce this W by L as well as ID, the drain current, then the transconductance value of this PMOS can be reduced. And if you just look at the expression for the voltage gain, this voltage gain is given by the ratio of GMN upon GMP. So if you can reduce GMP, the transconductance of the PMOS, then the voltage gain can be increased. But as long as you are considering a fixed drain current, then the only option that is available to you to reduce the value of GM is to minimize W by L. But if you make any attempt to minimize W by L, then ultimately it will also hamper the corresponding voltage swing. So as a solution to this problem, what we can do is the drain current of the lower MOS, the drain current of the input MOS can be shared by another current source which is appearing in shunt with the diode connected load. Let me just show you the circuit diagram. So let me just add another current source load इंसान विद द डायरेक्ट कनेक्टेड लोड। This one is a direct connected load, and similarly here also, in the right hand part of the circuit, we do have another current source load. This one is the direct connected load for which the gate and the drain are connected together. And suppose these two potential being the same, so let it be VB. And let me, okay, before that, let me just, so this one, these two are nothing but the corresponding drain resistances. So let me just complete the circuit diagram with the input MOS. We have a current source over here. Let me just call on the different MOS devices like M1. Let this be M2. Let this be M3, M4, M5, say M6. So the total drain current, if I consider that the total drain current that is flowing through M1 was the same as before. So let it be ID1. So last time also, if I consider this circuit, so last time also the current that was flowing through this path, suppose let it be ID1. Here also the drain current that is flowing through this path is also ID1. But now this ID1 is being shared by two different sources. We have this direct connected load and this current source load. Now if I assume that these two, I mean the current is being shared equally. For example, let me assume that the current is being shared equally. That means 50% of the current is being shared by this current source load and the rest 50% is being shared by this direct connected load. So you can also change the corresponding proportion. Let this be like 60, 40, 70, 30, 80, 20, anything. To start with, I can consider that it is like 50% only. I mean the same. ID1 by 2 is being flown through this current, through this MOS, and the rest ID1 by 2 is being flown through this MOS. So what happens for the mutual conductance? The transconductance. We have found that if we just consider the mutual conductance expression for GM, once again, it was like twice, I think I may simply write mu, twice mu C ox W by L into ID. Now, as long as mu and C ox, they are fixed. And now here, we have reduced ID by 50%. So last time, the ID1 was flowing through this direct connected load. And this time, the current that is being flown through this M4 is nothing but ID1 by 2. Now to reduce GM by a factor of 50%, by a factor of 2, then this W by L, needs to be reduced by a factor of 2 only. Let me just clarify once again. If I just compare this situation with the previous situation, so last time we do have twice mu c ox w by l into id, and that time id was fixed. So to reduce gm, we have to reduce w by l only. So last time, if w by l is reduced by a factor of 4, then gm is going to reduce by a factor of 2. Now, if you reduce w by l by a factor of 4, then it is having serious implication on the value of VGS minus VTH, because if w by l is reduced by a factor of 4, then this VGS minus VTH will be increased by a factor of 2 to make this equation valid. Now, this time, our fundamental objective being the same, that means to reduce GM by a factor of 2. So now, if you reduce GM by a factor of 2, now already we have reduced ID by a factor of 2. So this time, ID is reduced by a factor of 2. So ID is reduced by a factor of 2. And then with this, if you reduce W by L by a factor of 2, then the combined effect will reduce GM by a factor of 2. So this time we can achieve a reduction of GM by a factor of 2 just by reducing W by L with a factor of 2. Now, if you just go back to this expression, so now you are reducing W by L by a factor of 2. So this time, this VGS minus VTH will be increased only by root 2. So last time it was increasing by a factor of 2. This time it is increasing by a factor of root 2 only. And moreover, if you just change the share, the current share, instead of having 50% and 50%, if you make it like, say, 60%, 40%, because this 50% will help me to explain it properly. But otherwise, if I consider that the 60% of the current is being shared by the current source load, then obviously the rest 40% will be shared by this particular MOS. So once again, if the current share of this MOS is reduced, say from 100% to say 50%, 50% to say 25%, 25% to say 10%, so then also, without changing the W by L ratio, the value of value of GM can be made very small. So here our objective was to make GM to reduce by a factor of 2. And that was accomplished by changing ID and W by L both, because we are considering 50%, 50% share. Now, if you increase the current share of this particular MOS, that is M3, more than 50%, then obviously this ID that is being flown through M4 will be even small. So let it be, say, 10% only. So there will be a root square root of 0.9. So the corresponding reduction in GM can be achieved without changing the W by L ratio, just by reducing the value of ID, just by reducing the value of the current, the drain current that is being flown through M4, you can very easily have a very small value for GM without changing W by L. And if you do not change W by L value for M4, then automatically there will be no change in this gate to source minus threshold voltage, that overdrive. So accordingly, the voltage headroom problem that we are talking about previously, it will not come into picture. So we are not changing WLP. Still, we are able to reduce the value of GM just by reducing the percentage share of the current through M. So that is the one advantage. But the disadvantage, as you understand, here you have to use more number of MOS devices instead of having, to represent the resistance. So last time we have used only two MOS to represent two resistance, RD1 and RD2. Now we have to use four different MOS devices. So that is the one disadvantage, you can say, with respect to the last one. But the advantage is pretty clear. Now, apart from this diode connected load, so we have seen that we can use diode connected load only in isolation as a load, or you can use diode connected load in shunt with the current source load. That can help you in reducing the value of mutual conductance, and automatically it will increase the expression for the voltage gain. Now, apart from that, you can also use a simple current source load, just like this. You can use simple current source load. Let me just for the simple current source load model. The upper MOS was acting as the load, and the lower MOS is the input device. And here also, obviously, let me just compute. Here also, you will have another MOS, which identifies another current source. So this one is VDD. Let me just call this one as M1, this one as M2, this one as M3, this one as M4, and say this one as M5. And we are applying input signal over here. Let me have VB1 and VB1 over here and VB2 over here. Now with this combination, with this current source load only, you can achieve the corresponding voltage gain to be like minus GM times RD. Once again, minus GM times RD. And for the current source load, this RD, once again, you can use a half circuit concept and break it as it is. If you just consider the half circuit model, and assuming that this potential to be fixed, so you're applying V1 over here and some VB. You're calculating V out 1. Then the expression for V out 1 upon V in 1, that is nothing but the voltage gain, is nothing but minus GM times RD. So what about RD over here? So you do have the RO, the output resistance resulting from this current source and the drain to source resistance of this input MOS. So it will be nothing but GMN, and then you have RON parallel ROP. So RON is nothing but the drain to source resistance resulting from this input MOS, that is M1, and ROP is nothing but the drain to source resistance, that is output resistance for this current source load. So this is the expression for the voltage gain. Now once again, here you can also increase the expression for this voltage gain using the concept of cascading. So we have seen that if you use the cascode kind of amplifier, it will be having the effect of increasing the output impedance. So that is the biggest advantage of using cascode amplifier. So if both the input device and the load, if they are connected in cascode fashion, I mean, apart from a simple common source stage, if you have an additional common gate stage over there, and if the same is also applicable for the load, because already during our discussion in unit 2, we have made a point that this cascode amplifier is not always, or cascode configuration is not always used as an amplifier. Sometimes it is also used as a current source load. So instead of having a simple current source load like this, you can also use a cascode kind of configuration so that the overall voltage gain can be enhanced. Now, I'm not just drawing the entire part, or I can also do that for the cascode stage. Let me just first draw the complete differential pair, and then using the half circuit concept, the expression for the voltage gain can be calculated. So first the cascode load. Common source followed by common gate. And then you do have the input side. Let me just complete this right hand part. So this cascode amplifier, we have already seen its implication in the last unit. And now we are making this cascode amplifier as an element in the differential amplifier as well. So this 4+4, 8 MOS devices are required, apart from the current source load. I mean this tailing current source. So they might be having a common potential. I mean these two potential might be the same. Let me just explain. So let me call this one as VB1. This one is also VB1. So that means these two gates can be connected together. This one is VB2. This one also VB2. Now this MOS is acting as the common gate stage, and ultimately the input is applied. Between these two MOS devices, that is Vin. So let me call this as M1, this as M2, M3, M4, M5, M6, M7, M8. And we'll be taking the output from these two terminals. So here we are involving altogether 8 MOS devices apart from the tailing current source. So the active MOS and the load is being represented by 8 MOS devices, M1, M2. So the input will be applied over here. The small signal input will be applied over here. So this is acting in the common source configuration. Then you do have this common gate stage for the input device at M3, and then this M5 M7 combination as a cascode load. And the same is also applicable for the right hand side. M2 and M4, they are the input mouse device, and M6 and M8, they are nothing but the load. And perhaps you can remember the expression for the output impedance for cascode configuration. For cascode configuration, if I just consider this M1, M3, this particular pair, so the output impedance for this cascode configuration R out, it can be represented like 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3, because you have to consider the body effect, multiplied with RO3, whole multiplied with RO1 plus RO3. So that was the overall expression for the ROUT. If I just consider this particular cascode configuration, if I just want to calculate the output resistance between this terminal and this terminal, so the output resistance was nothing but 1 plus GM3 plus GMB3 into RO3, whole multiplied with RO1 plus RO3. Now, with certain approximation, that can be written like, with certain approximation, if I just forget about the GMB3 and this plus sign over there, so that can be approximated as a simple first hand calculation. That can be simply written like GM3, RO3, RO1. Although it's an approximation, but you can write like this: GM3, RO3, RO1. So for the common gate stage, if you have a common gate stage over there, so a common gate stage is having the corresponding mutual conductance that is multiplied with the RO value of the common gate stage multiplied with the RO value of the common source stage. So for a simple rough calculation, that can be treated as the output resistance for the cascode configuration. So now here, whenever you are going to find out the overall gain, so once again you can consider the half circuit model. Let me just very quickly show you the half circuit model. And once you apply the half circuit model, then the rest of the calculation will be easier for you. So this one is the VDD. So we're taking the output from this terminal. So this is M1, this is M3, this one is M5, and this one is M7. So the overall gain, we can write like, I mean, if I just consider the magnitude of the gain, in fact, the gain will be negative. So first of all, since the input is applied over here, so you have to find out, or you have to consider the mutual conductance of this particular MOS. So the basic structure being the same, GM times RD. So that GM is nothing but the mutual conductance of the first MOS. So it is GM1. And in place of RD, you would have two different resistance resulting from the cascode configuration. One resistance that is coming because of M1, M3 combination, which is acting as a cascode configuration. And the second resistance is because of this load, M5, M7. And that is also appearing in cascode configuration. So if I follow this approximation, then we do have two resistances in shunt path, in parallel path. Then one is GM3, RO3, RO1, as you have already mentioned. In fact, that is an approximated version. If you'd like to find out the exact value, then this is the exact value for the output resistance. Now this is in shunt with GM5, RO5, RO7. because of the appearance or because of this cascode load, then automatically the RD value, the effective value of RD, in fact, here this is the effective value of the RD, this entire thing. This is the effective RD, or R effective, I can say. So instead of writing like only RON parallel ROP, if you just follow this cascode configuration, then automatically the, even for a fixed GM value, this R effective will be increased, because that is the one of the advantage of having the cascode configuration, to increase the output impedance. And since we use cascode configuration as load over here, so automatically the expression for the voltage gain will be also increased. But obviously, the voltage headroom problem, because we are using so many MOS devices in the series path, as you understand, we have, so this is the supply line, VDD. And apart from that, you have four MOS devices, M1, M3, M5, and M7. And you understand what about the maximum voltage swing over here. So maximum voltage swing is nothing but VDD minus the gate to source overdrive for this MOS, that is VGS minus VTH1, then VGS minus VTH3, then VGS minus VTH5 mod of this, and then VGS minus VTH7. So the available voltage swing is VDD minus this. So accordingly, the voltage swing is reduced, because that is one of the disadvantages of having this cascode configuration, because you are using more number of MOS devices, and you have to provide the corresponding headroom for the gate to source voltage, gate to source variation. And accordingly, the available voltage swing is limited, but you can increase the voltage gain by invoking this cascode configuration. So with this, I would like to conclude this discussion of unit 3, that is on a differential amplifier.